private person, and without question, I stuffed up in my personal life, and I accept that. It's very difficult for someone in my position to have a private and personal life, and I'm very upset at what has transpired. But I want to make this assurance to the people of New South Wales. I have always put the public first. I have always made sure the public interest is first and foremost paramount in every single thing that I do. The integrity of the role I have, the office that I hold, is the greatest privilege of my life. And whilst I have made this mistake in my personal life, I intend to serve the people of New South Wales to the best of my ability. That's what I've always done. I've sacrificed my life to public office, and I'm proud of that. The position I hold is a privileged one. It is an honour to serve the people of the state, and I look forward to maintaining my focus to keep everybody safe, to keep jobs going during a very difficult time for the state. But I want to state at the outset that had I known then what I know now, clearly I would not have made those personal decisions that I did. I trusted someone that I'd known for a long time, and I feel really, really let down. I trusted him for a long time. We were colleagues for 15 years, and I'm not going to take away from the fact that I made a mistake in my personal life, but I have to say that there is huge separation between a personal life and public office. And I can't stress enough that every day that I've been in this job, I have held myself accountable to the highest standards, and I've held my colleagues to the highest standards. And I say to all the colleagues, all the public servants, all the people that I've worked with, they know me, they know who I am. Many of you standing here know me and know who I am. And I will continue to put the people of this state first and foremost in all of my activities. I'm now going to let my deputy say a few words, and Minister Hazzard wants to give a quick update, and then of course I'll take all your questions for as long as you'd like me to take your questions.
Well, thank you, Premier. Can I say it's great to be here with the Premier today to offer my support to her. It's been a very difficult day, but she is somebody of the utmost integrity, honesty, and is somebody who has stood by her side as the Deputy Leader and Treasurer of this state. Never have I seen someone work so hard, a person of high integrity and honesty, and somebody who puts the people of New South Wales first and foremost. She's somebody that has not taken a day's leave over the course of this last year, a year which has been incredibly difficult for the people of our state. And I know, whether it's been through the bushfires, the floods, the drought, and this pandemic, that we could have no leader better than Gladys Berejiklian to take our state through this difficult time. I know every single day she is somebody who is selfless, and she is somebody that is focused on one thing and one thing only, and that is the betterment of our people. And yes, it has been a difficult day for her, and a difficult day for the government, but can I say, as the Deputy Leader of the party, that she is somebody of the utmost integrity and honesty. It has been an absolute pleasure to be by her side during what has been such a very difficult period of time. And I know that, most importantly, her focus, continued focus, and her tireless work ethic ensures that our state is in the best place possible. And we know throughout this entire pandemic, the shining light of this country when it comes to which state is driving our nation through this once in a 100-year economic crisis, it has been the state of New South Wales. And that is no accident. That is no accident at all. That has been because of the fearless leadership that Gladys Berejiklian has taken our state through this very, very difficult time. And this is a crisis that is far from over. This is one that will need the leadership, the strongest leadership possible, to keep our state moving, to keep as many people in work, to keep as many people safe as possible. And I'd like to say, as the deputy and as somebody who works incredibly closely with Gladys Berejiklian, has worked closely over the last 3 years, there is no one in this state more selfless and more focused on keeping our people safe, on keeping businesses in business, and keeping people in jobs. She's a person of highest integrity are honesty and so dedicated to the betterment of people of New South Wales. And it's great to be here as her deputy today of the Liberal Party, support her in what has been a very difficult day.
Oh, I have a public health alert to make. Before I do that, I just want to say, in regard to the events of today, I've known the Premier for more than 20 years, and I have to say she is an outstanding person. She is a person of great integrity. She is by far the best Premier in this country, and each one of us should know that when she goes to work each day, she is only focused on one thing, and that is making sure that the citizens of New South Wales are well cared for. I have lived and worked more than 20 hours a day in some cases with the Premier in the last 8 to 9 months during this COVID crisis, and she has been an outstanding leader. Why we are in the position we are today is because of the incredible work she has done with each of the other government agencies, and particularly the senior health officials who all hold her in very high regard. I just want to emphasise that I don't think we would have been in such a good place today if Gladys Berejiklian had not been our Premier. Also, of course, through the fires and through the floods, she's been amazing. So I just want to say 100% backing our Premier. Now, as to the public health alert, each one of us would know today COVID hasn't stopped. Fortuitously, the state has had a good result today with just one case of locally acquired, locally transmitted COVID-19. There are five travellers who are in hotel quarantine up to 8 p.m. last night. So that is certainly, we are very appreciative of the fact that we continue to have the hotel quarantine arrangements, because that's certainly keeping us all safe. Can I say the public health alert? This afternoon, we're detailing some other concerns we have, and I'd like the community to be very aware of this, because there may be a lot of people who have been through this particular facility. Two new cases of COVID-19 have been linked to a medical clinic in Lakemba. Both cases, unfortunately, are general practitioners in that practice. They worked at the A to Z Medical Clinic at 96 Holden Street, Lakemba. The two new cases are linked to a previously reported case in a patient who attended Lakemba Radiology. Now, New South Wales Health is in the process of contacting everyone considered to be a close contact of these cases. And I stress, obviously, as they're GPs in the practice, we expect there'll be quite a number of people who may have been in close contact with them. These close contacts should be tested immediately and isolate for a full 14 days from exposure, regardless of any results of any tests. And casual contacts of these two GPs, of these cases, must monitor for symptoms and then get tested and isolate immediately if they develop any symptoms. And after testing, they should remain in isolation until a negative result is achieved. I'd also just like to point out that New South Wales Health will be contacting anyone directly to provide tailored advice depending on their exposure, particularly on Thursday the 1st of October from 2:30 to 3:30, Friday the 9th of October from 3 till 4:30, and Saturday 10th of October all day. And that circular will be put out shortly. Again, thank you for making sure these public health notices get out to the broader community. Thank you.
I've made my position clear today in the evidence that I gave, and it's fair to say that a number of people were approached in government, a number of public servants were approached, and the good news is that everybody held their ground and did what was right in the interests of the public. Everybody held their ground, and this person was not able to acquire anything, or his friends or his associates. And I want to take this opportunity to wholeheartedly thank all of the public servants, all of my colleagues, who at every opportunity made sure they did the right thing, made sure that this person did not get any personal benefit, and that is what is at the heart of the issue here. He had a go quite a few many times, but nothing transpired. And I want to say strongly to the people of this state, there is one way to come to the government to get things done, and that's through the front door, through proper process. And I'm pleased to say the process has held up because nobody was able to gain a benefit from trying to get around the process, from trying to influence, from trying to cajole. That did not occur. And that is what I want to thank all of the public servants, all of the colleagues, everybody who was approached, ensured that at every opportunity, proper processes of this government were held to account. And that is what is important.
Premier, you repeatedly say that you kept the personal and the professional separate. But in those phone taps that we heard you say to Mr. Maguire, we heard you ask Mr. Maguire, has Sarah from Royal Prince called you about that? We also heard you say, oh, they think it's in your electorate, I didn't say anything. How can we really trust that you kept that separate when clearly you were having those professional conversations with him?
But I would have had those conversations with other colleagues as well to see if they'd been in touch with my office or if they'd dealt with my office. There is nothing I did which did not put the people of New South Wales first. People may have tried to influence me, people may have tried to get around proper process, but they failed. They failed to get to me around proper process, and that is what is important. I hold the integrity of this government to the highest standard, and what is comforting in what I regard as a personal nightmare, and I will call it a personal nightmare, you cannot appreciate, for someone who's very private, for someone who is very by the book, for someone who put her trust in someone she thought she could trust, I'd known him for 15 years, I can't tell you what it's done to me personally. It's been devastating, and I've had to bear this on top of everything else. But I want everybody to know that notwithstanding the personal pressures I was under, the personal challenges that I've had, that at every opportunity I've worked hard my guts out for the people of this state because I've always put the people first. Public service is a sacrifice, and whether it's my deputy who has a number of children, and I know what he sacrifices to do his job, and similarly the health minister, I know what he sacrificed to do his job, and public service is a sacrifice. And I just want the public to know that never ever have I done anything but to completely serve the public. Never ever have I done anything but what is the highest standard of integrity. And where I have failed is in my personal life, and I accept that. I take full responsibility for that. I take full responsibility for that. In fact, this was a relationship I did not share with anybody, not my family, not my closest friends. It was not a relationship that I regarded of sufficient status, but yet I will say that I don't want to take away the responsibility for my actions and say I'm human, but I am. I'm human, and I stuffed up in my personal life. And for someone who's extremely private and extremely cautious and very conservative in the way she leads her life, it's been very difficult to have that out on full display. And I also want to make this point, and I feel very strongly about this. I know that many women and girls are very proud of the role that I play and the job that I do. And I want to say to everybody, there's nothing wrong with being a strong, independent, financially independent woman. And I don't want assumptions made that women can't be independent, can't be financially independent, can't make decisions for themselves, are unduly influenced by others. That is not what strong women do. That is not what strong women are. And I just want to say to all the girls and women out there that please know that it's okay to be in public office. It's okay to make the sacrifices, but it's also okay to accept that we're far from perfect. And certainly I'm far from perfect. But what I can say is that at every opportunity, I serve the people with every ounce of my body, with every ounce of my being. That I hold the office I hold with enormous privilege, and I will continue to do that.
Have you considered resigning?
No, I haven't, because I haven't done anything wrong. If I had done something wrong, I would be the first one to do that. If I had done something wrong, I would be the first one to consider my position, but I haven't.
Why would you think you could be in breach? Do you think you could be in breach? be in breach of the ministerial code, Premier, by not declaring the pecuniary interest of someone with whom you're in an intimate...
No, because the ICAC was very careful in the definition they used. In terms of close personal relationship, they were very careful, and I've not been accused of any wrongdoing.
Premier, why didn't you end your relationship with Daryl Maguire back in 2018 when the first corruption inquiry took place?
Yeah, that is a very good question, and can I say that initially he was very angry with me. I was extremely angry with him. I sacked him. I asked for his resignation. Then I not only convinced him to leave Parliament, but accosted others to help me convince him to leave Parliament. But I also have to say, from a compassionate position, this is a person who, again, I put yourself in my position. I've known him for 15 years. He lost his career, his friends. He lost everything, and he was in a very dark place. And I didn't feel that I could stop being his friend during that time, rightly or wrongly, on compassionate grounds. But put yourself in a situation. Imagine if one of your best friends had done something horrible. On compassionate grounds, would you care about their welfare if they're in a dark place, they've lost everything? And that's, I just felt that I could not stop being his friend, rightly or wrongly. But of course, can I say this, had I known then what I know now, I mean, I don't want to prejudice the hearing that's going on at the moment. But can I say in a general statement, had I known then what I know now, of course I would have had nothing to do with him, but I did not know the extent of what he was alleged to have done. I'm sorry? No, can I be very clear here? Parliamentary secretaries and members of Parliament are allowed to have business interests. They're allowed to conduct business activity so long as they disclose them. And I assumed, as I do with every colleague, that if you are engaging in any transaction, in any deal, that you disclose that appropriately. And parliamentary secretaries in particular, even ministers, are allowed to have business interests so long as they declare any conflicts and provide all the disclosures. So there is nothing actually wrong with someone undertaking a business interest. What is wrong, and this is the key point, what is wrong is using your public office to do that or failing to disclose the interest that you've accumulated.
And if you trusted that he disclosed all his interests, why did you say to him those times, I don't need to know about that, I don't need to know about that?
Well, I refer you to the evidence I gave today, and they were his interests. I didn't have any interest in them. I didn't care too much about his interests because it was his responsibility to disclose them, as is the responsibility of every member of Parliament. And when you've known, and this is my failing, when you've known someone for a long time and you put your trust in them, you assume they're doing the right thing, and that's what I assumed. I assumed he was doing the right thing. I had my trust in him, and obviously I know now that that trust was misplaced, and I accept that human failing on my part, and I accept it wholeheartedly. And I know, because many people have already contacted me to say that they've been through experiences where they trusted somebody and they've been let down. But I don't want to take away from the personal responsibility I bear for that, because I did trust him. My trust was misplaced, and I deeply regret that. It is a very difficult time for me in my life to accept that, but I have to. And when you go through a personal crisis, you dust yourself off, learn from it and move forward. And I also want to state unequivocally that I've always been cognizant of the separation of my personal life from my public duty and public responsibility, and that remains the case. And I hope the public knows, and I certainly feel the public appreciates, that I don't always get it right in terms of executing my public responsibilities, but I certainly work my guts out, and I certainly ensure that at every stage the highest level of integrity is applied to the way in which I do my job.
Yeah.
I'm sorry? Can I say that question wasn't put to me today, but I asked my staff, I understand, but I asked my staff to advise me whether we had any note or any document which expressed those concerns from that minister's office, and my office said that they did not receive anything. So that was not brought to my attention. And I specifically, and if I was asked today, I would have answered that question in that way. But I specifically asked my office because I wanted to know the same thing, Liz. I wanted to know why I wasn't told. And I asked my office checked all the records, and there is no record of my office having received any information about that. Because I asked exactly the same thing. That's the first thing I asked. Why wasn't I told? Why didn't I know? And when I asked my staff to check those documents, they said that there was no official receipt. And if I was asked today, I would have answered that question. But clearly, I wasn't asked that question. And I have confidence in the process, and the process has obviously done, you know, substantial research and investigation, and that they could have put that question to me today and they didn't. I'm sorry? No, well, that's not my position. That's actually the position of the disclosure requirements. That's not my position. I didn't make up those rules. The interest disclosure, the parliamentary disclosure, the ministerial code of conduct. In fact, the ministerial code of conduct was updated in 2014 under Premier Baird, and the pecuniary interest register has been around for a long time. So they're not my rules. They're the rules of the parliament, and they're the rules of the ministerial code of conduct. No, but you're making assumptions that I didn't know. You're making assumptions that there was a connection there. In fact, just be careful, because ICAC is actually making those investigations. It's for them to look at that, but that's yet to be determined.
We heard evidence today at the ICAC that Daryl Maguire put it to you that he said that he was set to make money from his deal at Badger Creek at the time. We also heard evidence in the ICAC regarding Maguire and talking to your office why didn't you do something about that?
Oh, the second part of your question is not actually accurate, but in relation to the first part, I was asked that question today and answered appropriately in that I was not aware of any specifics, and if there was any interest, it should have been disclosed at the appropriate time. And in fact, the integrity body is still investigating whether any interest actually materialised, and that's for them to decide. Yeah. No. It was, yeah, I think most of my colleagues acknowledge that pie in the sky and big talking was part of who he was. So. No, well, it doesn't. It doesn't. But what does pass the test is the fact that I had no knowledge, no details, and I assume that all of my colleagues have to disclose their interests at the right time. All of my colleagues, it depends on the interest. Sometimes you have to have ongoing disclosure. Sometimes you have to do it on the pecuniary interest register. Depending on the office you hold, you have to make those disclosures. And at that time, as I said, because I trusted him, I had no reason at the time to imagine that he was doing anything wrong, because I trusted him, and I assumed that if there was any interest to be declared, that he did that. That if there was any interest to register, that he did that. And that's yet to be determined.
Premier, you've spoken about being a role model for girls and women. What about Mr. Maguire's wife? Was he still married
when you started? Look, that's a matter for him, but my understanding was that he was separated. No, I was already on leave at the time. Yeah, I was already on leave. Gosh, no. No, because I was unaware of those issues prior to the 13th of July.
When should have you, in hindsight, should you have declared a relationship with him or made it public to more people? Because do you accept that, you know, as a Premier or a Minister, having a secret relationship with someone who does have dealings with government potentially opens you to, opportunities for bribery, opportunities for all sorts?
Well, it wasn't, the relationship wasn't of sufficient status for me to talk to anybody about it. I didn't even talk to my family about it because it wasn't of a sufficient status. But I've been very open today with the ICAC. I actually made sure that they were aware in terms of what I felt about it, but it didn't have sufficient status for me to share with anybody. Let alone the, I did not feel that it had sufficient status for me, and I wasn't sure about its future, to be honest. And these are very difficult things to talk about. But if I did, I would have obviously made those matters known. But I did not regard it as sufficient status at that stage to be able to make that public, or in fact tell people closest around me.
I
answered that question this morning. Yeah.
I mean, you agreed with the assertion of
No, well, I made clear that I was I made clear just before that I was concerned with his welfare. I'd known him for 15 years, and rightly or wrongly, whilst I knew what he'd done was very bad. In fact, not only did I ask him to resign from the Parliamentary Liberal Party, not only did I ask him to sit on the crossbench, but I also engaged the support of others to convince him to resign from Parliament. Yep. I'm sorry, I can't hear what you're saying.
Before 2018, yeah. You agreed that it would have been preferable to you in your relationship and her public relationship when Mr. Maguire left politics, when you were discussing.
Well, that was, well, they were hypothetical matters. I didn't know where things were going. As I said, it wasn't of sufficient status for me to be able to make that call. These are intensely personal matters, and I think all of us would know in our private lives. For those of you who haven't had to go through what I've been through, you're very fortunate, because in my position, it's very difficult to have a private life and a personal life, and it's very difficult to make sure that you not only put your trust in the right people, and that's the other thing that I feel very disappointed about in myself. I am normally a very good judge of character. I'm normally very good at judging people, and I feel that I really let myself down on this occasion, and I feel very bad about it. And it's something I'll carry for a long time. And I will, trust now is a big issue for me, because I thought that I could trust him. I knew him for a long time. And again, for someone who's very private, these are very difficult things to talk about, but I'm doing it because I want to be very open and let people know that I'm more than human. I made a big mistake in my personal life. I always kept my personal life separate from my public responsibility, and that my first and foremost priorities to the people of this great state, and it will continue to be.
What was it that made you think that Daryl Maguire needed to be sacked from Parliament and was no longer fit to be an MP, but was still fit to be in a post-personal?
Well, that's where you separate the personal from the public office. When my public position was in question about what to do with this MP, I did not hesitate. I sacked him from the parliamentary party, I forced him onto the backbench, and then eventually I engaged the help of others, because he wouldn't resign from Parliament, for him to resign from Parliament. That was my public responsibility. But in my personal life, I don't know about you guys, but when you've known someone for a long time, they've really stuffed up, they've lost everything, they're in a very dark place, and I don't want to, as bad as his actions were, I don't want to divulge his personal circumstances. But I didn't feel that I could not support him as a friend during that very difficult time in his life. And I know it may not have been on the public record, but his son-in-law died the day I sacked him, and I carried a bit of guilt about those circumstances. And I didn't feel that after he'd lost everything, again, perhaps some of you would make a different decision, but think about people you've known in your life for 15 years who you'd been close to for a long time. And when he was in that very dark place, I didn't feel that I could just stop being his friend, his close friend. I'm sorry? It wasn't a sufficient status then to be able to progress it, because, as difficult as this is for me, I do not know to this date the truthfulness about how he felt about me and their matters before the ICAC. So. No, well, no. No, I questioned everything on July 13, 2018.
You said earlier, referring to him, that his ICOs are very careful in not classifying the relationship.
Yeah.
There are different...
There are.
Yeah. Which states that a family member is someone with whom you have a...
Yeah, that's why they used the language that they did.
Hmm. So he wasn't someone with
whom... No. No, no.
And can I ask you a second question on this issue? A number of your colleagues it's been raised that you have been quite strict on members of the Liberal Party having undisclosed relationships with other members of the Liberal Party, staff and members of staff and other staff.
He wasn't a staff member.
Members having relationships with other members.
Right. I've never questioned that. I've never questioned two consenting adults that don't work in the same office is a matter for them. Yeah, there's nothing wrong with that. You look at the federal parliament, look how many members have ended up married. Look how many federal members are in relationships, or state members for that matter. I think there's a problem if it's a member of your staff, but if it's two consenting adults who happen to be members of parliament, I don't know since when that was disallowed. I mean, there's lots of examples of members of parliament who've actually gone on to have long-term futures together. I'm sorry, can you just speak up a little bit? Oh, look, they're intensely personal questions, but as I said, in my view, the relationship didn't have sufficient status for me to define it in that terms. It was a close personal relationship, but it did not have sufficient status for me to be able to call him any of those things. And I've tried to be as frank as possible with everybody who's asked me those questions. Yeah. Well, no. To me, a close relationship, a close personal relationship, is a closeness you have with somebody. But obviously, the dynamics change substantially, and I was there to support him as a close friend.
You also said today, Premier, that he was made aware of the fact that his close personal relationship had come to an end. How was he made aware of that? Did you
Look, they're matters that I've disclosed to the ICAC, and they're satisfied with my response. But I don't want to prejudice ongoing investigations.
The Labor Party is going to move a motion of no confidence. You, the Premier, tomorrow, if you remain in that role, are you confident it will succeed?
Oh, look, I suspected they would do that, and that is their prerogative. But I'm confident I've got the support of my colleagues.
Well, that is the hardest press conference Gladys Berejiklian will ever give. In that press conference, she admits, in her words, she's stuffed up. I trusted him, that is the disgraced MP Daryl Maguire, and I feel let down by him. She said she's been through a personal nightmare, but then added, I have not done anything wrong.